the 9-year-old Chronicles, and this is the fourth in a row season 68-69. Now, if you were watching the television back in the day, the season kicked off, the league season anyway, kicked off on Saturday the 7th of September. You'd have been watching Grandstand in the usual fashion, and then Doctor Who would have been on with Patrick Troughton. After the news, the new Lucy show, Lucille Ball, and then it would have been Simon D with D-Time. Then Dixon and Doc Green, then the Black and White Minstrel Show. If they're under the age of 40, you would never have seen this when it was on the television at the time. Go on to YouTube, and then you'll need a plaster for your jaw as it's hit the ground. Marty Feldman with the Marty Show, then Saturday Thriller, Cry Terror, then the news, then Match of the Day, then Kindly Leave the Stage, and then all TV shut down. Playing in the background is I Gotta Get a Message to You by the Bee Gees, and at the end of this, but you've got to be careful who I put on, because it's picked up by YouTube and they chuck it off. Anything by the Beatles, it's Get Back by the Beatles is at the end of this podcast. It was number one on Wednesday the 30th of April 1969 when the league season finished. And on TV on the night the season finished on Wednesday the 30th of April, Kids TV was Jack and Ori, Marine Boy, Animal Magic presenting Journey to Lapland, which seems a bit odd in April to have a Journey to Lapland programme. Anyway, Magic Roundabout, then the news, then it would have been Softly Softly versus I'm Sorry I'll Read That Again, presented by John Junkin. Then staple of the 70s and 80s, Tomorrow's World, The Newcomers, The Good Old Days, which I only ever remember being on Saturday night during the 70s, unfortunately falling asleep and not having to watch it. Then Harry Worth, The News, a Liberal Party political broadcast. Then The Wednesday Play. Then 24 Hours, whatever that was. Animal Business. And then all television shutting down at 20 past 11. Anyway, this is a treble season. This is season 68-69. And this is Lackey Moore, St. Anthony and Robert. Right, gents, we're all ready to talk about the fourth in the 9-in-a-row seasons. This is season 68-69. Tumultuous times happening across the world. There was the Prague Spring. For younger listeners, the Soviet Union's dominance over Eastern Europe led to what's referred to as the Iron Curtain coming down through the middle of Germany, or through two-thirds of Germany, a third of Germany, and taking out Poland and Czechoslovakia and Hungary and Romania, although I'll touch on Romania in a minute. And they were all under the influence of the Soviet Union and weren't allowed to do what they wanted, and so there was some momentous events involving Celtic with that. But we will start off as usual. First of all, Lackey, did you manage to get to many games in the 68-69 season?
I was at more games than I remember. There were some games I was at that I thought, I was at that game when I was looking at them. But at the time, I was obviously still in England, so it was a case of coming back up and down. I was at the Rangers games, curiously. I can't even remember one of them. I know I was at it.
Robert, were you managing to get to many games by this point?
Yeah, I was at quite a lot of the home games that season, including a couple of the European nights. Wasn't really going to away games at that stage, but when I looked through the fixture list, just getting ready for this podcast, I did see a lot of games that came back into memory and, you know, just odd moments from each games, and we get a chance to talk about some of these on the podcast today.
One of the interesting things I mentioned, forgot to mention in the last podcast that changed the way football was a wee bit, was in the previous season. That's when goalkeepers were stopped from taking more than four steps unless they bounced the ball. So that was the start of there. So as always, we start with the League Cup campaign and the League Cup section that Celtic were in. This season had Rangers, Morton, Partick Thistle, not too difficult a League Cup section, with the exception obviously of the Rangers. So did you get to any of those games, Lackey?
I think it was at the home game. I have this memory of the game at Ibrox, and I think I was working that day, but I'm not sure. I remember it was, I think that was the day that the Black Walk was in Bella Houston Park, and there was this joke about whether you were going to the cakewalk or the Black Walk. Probably. I remember, you know, I wrote about that in time, but I remember the goals from seeing them in television, you know, over the years. But I don't remember being at the game. I think I must have been working that day.
George is right there to say that the Black Walk was a big thing that day when Celtic played Rangers at Ibrox. I think it was the opening game of the season, the League Cup game. Mm-hmm. And it shows you how you just cannot imagine this happening these days. On the police recommendation, that the kickoff at Ibrox was moved to 3:30 to accommodate the Black Walk marching along Paisley Road West.
Yeah,
that shows you how times have changed. And as much as these days, that would be, they would be hunted for that. They would be told, you're not marching in that day. Can you imagine that the powder? I mean, it must have been a powder keg atmosphere. There was something like 80,000 people at Ibrox. Celtic right. playing Rangers. We were only drinking those days. The emotions running high. And you've got these characters, Martin Langley, Paisley Road West, 10,000 strong. Crazy to think.
And glorious sunshine into the bargain as well. That's what I remember about the game at Ibrox. Fabulous weather and the fact we had the game wrapped up pretty much by half time.
Yeah.
And, you know, John Gregg, who was Mr. Reliable for them, got caught twice dithering on the ball, and in both occasions Willie Wallace scored. The other interesting thing from just looking at the report on the match was that Jimmy Johnson was number 8 that day, mm-hmm. and that Steen had brought in George Connolly, an extra body in midfield, and Jimmy was given more of a free rein to move about wherever he wanted to try and unsettle the Rangers defence, and it certainly seems to have worked because he was involved in both the goals as well. So it was a great League Cup campaign. We couldn't, I mean, just like the Lisbon season, we won all 6 games in the group. And for the second season in a row, we managed to eliminate Rangers at the group stage.
Yeah.
And which was always a good thing. And, it was to continue in future seasons as well, as we will discuss.
The home game, when we won 1-0, was very controversial, because that was the game that Callaghan did not order John Hughes off, and Rangers protested, and that was effectively the end of his career as a top class referee. Celtic won 1-0.
But what exactly happened, George? I think it's not exactly clear.
I think he'd already been booked, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But then I think he got involved in an altercation in midfield with a Rangers player, which would have merited another booking and an ordering off.
Mm-hmm. Lackey, I thought that was the following season.
I think it was that season, because it was a very tight game.
No, I remember that. But the following season, we also beat them 1-0 at Parkhead in the League Cup. And the reason I say that, and Tom Gemmell scored.
You're right. Yeah, you're right. That was the night Gemmell scored.
Gemmell scored with a diving header. The reason why I was quite sure about that was because when we got onto the sunny subject of beating Rangers 4-0 in the cup final, Callaghan was the referee that day.
Was he? Right.
You're right. This is a conversation for the next podcast, I think, right?
But that your discussions of that game are spot on, as per the Celtic Wiki. The game kicked off at 3:30 to avoid clashes with the 4,000 marchers in the Black Walk at Bella Houston Park. Celtic took the unusual step of urging those supporters who felt they were unable to resist retaliation not to turn up at Ibrox for the game through the pages of the Celtic View. The club went out of their way to try and avoid any disturbances starting from Celtic supporters. Rangers also appealed to their rowdier elements not to disrupt the game. Having said that, a fight broke out in the Celtic end just before time up. Steve named his team on the Friday. Bertiol was not quite 100% fit. He had come back this season after a cartilage operation at the end of the previous season. John Clark was named as a sub with Jim Brogan starting at left half position. Celtic team was Simpson, Gemmell, O'Neill, Murdoch, McNeil, Brogan, Connolly, Johnson, Wallace, Lennox, Hughes, and they won 2-0. On the same day, Celtic reserves beat Rangers reserves 2-1. That's the other thing. You used to have the reserves playing at exactly the same time as the first team. I can remember when there was a period in the sort of early mid 80s. One of my brothers was a ball boy at Celtic Park, and he would be a ball boy at home games when the reserves were playing at home and the team would play away. And I remember going to a few reserve games. This was in the 80s. I remember going to a few reserve games, and there'd be a good few hundred people in the stand, but it'd be really odd because nothing would be happening in the pitch, and there'd suddenly be a huge cheer would go up because Celtic would have scored at the game, and everyone's listening to the radio. The Reserve League Cup team was Wraith, Craig, Gorman, McMahon, Hay, Katanak, Chalmers, McBride, Quinn, Gallagher, McCarry, with Billy Murdoch as a sub. So that was that. But as you quite rightly say, Robert, and if either of you want to interject about any of these games, the League Cup was Celtic winning 2-0 at Ibrox. They thumped Morton 4-1 at Celtic Park, thumped Thistle 4-0 at Celtic Park, then beat Rangers again at Celtic Park 1-0, Morton away 3-0, and then they won away to Thistle 6-1. Again, managing to keep that, the furthest they had to travel was to Greenock. In the next round, they played Hamilton, where they won 10-0 at Celtic Park and 4-2 at Hamilton. Semi-final, they beat Clyde 1-0, and then there was the 6-2 final against Hibs. So who wants to talk about any of those games?
Can I come in there just to say, as much as a nondescript game, Hamilton away and you're 10-0 up for the first leg, it was Dalglish's debut at Douglas Park when Celtic won 4-2. Come on, as a sub for Charlie Gallagher.
I thought he made his debut against Wraith Rovers.
That was his league debut, but his first ever game for Celtic was as a substitute for Charlie Gallagher in the League Cup against Hamilton Accies. And very sad to hear last night that it's not exactly clear what's wrong with him. He has got the coronavirus. I don't think he's got symptoms, thankfully, but there's something not right because he's been in hospital. So just to say, best wishes and get well soon to Kenny.
The Clive game was a very tight game, and Harry Hood was playing for Clive, and they played really, really well. It was a most uncomfortable evening. I remember that one. And the final was actually played in the spring because there was a fire at Hampden. And the final should have been played in October or something.
Yeah, sorry, I was going to say, I was at the Hamilton Accies game, which we won 10-0. And it was also Lou McCarry's first start that night. He was at outside right in place of Jimmy. But that night against Hamilton Accies, Bobby Lennox and Stevie Chalmers both scored 5 each, which was an extraordinary achievement. And I'm thinking that 10-0 victory was probably the second biggest win in Celtic's history. I know there had been a bigger win against Dundee in the previous century, and I don't think we had scored 10 in a match before or since. And you know, within that League Cup run, Willie Wallace had scored 4 against Thistle at Parkhead. Bobby Lennox had scored 5 in the Firhill return. So there was incredible scoring achievements.
Chalmers got 5-2 against Hamilton.
Yeah, Chalmers against Hamilton Accies, yeah. Him and Bobby Lennox. Yeah. As Lackey says, the final was scheduled for Hampden in October. The players were actually down at Sea Mill preparing for the game when they heard that there had been a fire, there had been an arson attack at Hampden, which destroyed a chunk of the south stand. And curiously, there had been an arson attack at Ibrox in the same month. From what I can see, I couldn't determine whether there was any convictions made in either case, although there was quite a lot of conspiracy theories kicking around. Lackey, do you remember anything about the fires?
No. Well, I was away. Yeah, I didn't even see the Scottish papers.
Yeah, so I dug out some old Evening Times, which referred to the fires, referred to the damage. But I couldn't find anything to say who was responsible or, you know, why it had happened. But yeah, the final was deferred until April, which was a great month for us because we won everything that month.
I'm just, as you're talking, I'm looking on this day in 1968, the Glasgow Herald headline: "Who has been setting fire to Glasgow football grounds? Special guard on football grounds." Because of fire breaking out at both at Hampden and at Ibrox. And Sean Fallon said, "We will be taking every possible precaution." And Clyde said they were also keeping a close watch on Sheffield Stadium around the clock. So obviously a worry of the time that it's not a coincidence, it's two. Your point, Robert, about the goals, you're right. Celtic's biggest league win and biggest win is 11-0 against Dundee in October 1895. Our biggest Scottish Cup win is 8-0 against Cowlairs in 1888. But our biggest League Cup win is 10-0 against Hamilton Academicals on the 11th of September 1968.
That's the one.
Yeah, so
glad I was there.
Yes, you were there for the record-breaking win. So we breezed through that, and then we played Hibs on the 5th of April 1969. So did you manage to make the League Cup final?
No,
me neither. I remember watching it on television. It was also fantastic weather. And we were 6-0 at one point in the game, I recall.
So it was it's quite remarkable to score 6 goals in any game, but to score them in a cup final. The team that day, John Hughes was missing through injury. The team was Fallon, Craig, Gemmell, Murdoch, McNeil, Brogan, Johnson, Wallace, Chalmers, Alden, Lennox.
That's a familiar forward line.
Yeah. Lennox got a hat trick. Craig scored.
Yeah.
Old scored. Yeah,
that's a collector's item when Jim Craig scores.
Yeah. And you're right, Hibs, it was two consolation goals, 82nd and 87th minute. The Hibs team was Allen, Shevlin, Davis, Stanton, Madsen, Blackley, Marinello, Quinn, Cormack, O'Rourke, Stevenson, with Hunter as the subs.
Decent team.
Decent. That's a good team.
Yeah, decent team indeed. One of the things I note from that team, obviously, is the goalkeeper was Fallon. Following on from your comments last week, Lackey, your favourite goalkeeper, he ended up made 33 appearances that season to Simpson's 24. So Fallon took over, mainly being the main goalkeeper between the sticks during that season. What were your thoughts on that at the time?
Well, Ronnie Simpson was injured, so he was the next person to to play. They didn't have any other goalkeeper really, other than the boy. He did well. I mean, he had a brilliant game in the Scottish Cup final against Rangers.
Yeah, this was the Simpson injury you referred to, Lackey.
Yeah.
Last time round at the Sheffield at the Scottish Cup game when Tommy Gale had to play in goals, I think, for most of the second half.
Yeah. The curious thing about that, although Tommy Gale played almost two halves, like a whole game, almost a whole game in goal between two different games, he never let a goal in. So he played nearly all of the second half at Fir Hill in a game earlier on in the 60s, and then he played almost, I don't know when. Did he not play the whole of the second half against the Clyde? But he certainly never let a goal in.
No, it's no.
That's right. He had a good record in goal, Tommy Gimmel.
So we secured the League Cup in that season, and the league campaign kicked off on the 7th of September, where we had our usual. Now, this is another thing that modern fans, in the modern world, the league champions kick off the start of the following season at home.
Yeah.
Unfurl the flag, etc. We were away to Clyde. We seem to be playing Clyde at the beginning of every season. During this 9-in-a-row run, we were away to Clyde in the first game of the season, and we beat them 3-0. Similar to the previous season, actually, we won the first game, and then the next two games, we lost and drew. So after doing so well against Rangers in the League Cup, we then come up against them in the second game of the season on the 14th of September, and we lose at home 4-2.
Yeah. If I remember correctly, Willie Johnson ran right that day.
Yeah, he scored twice.
Yeah, he was brilliant.
An interesting stat, if you like, about Willie Johnson, that he scored, I think it was 7 goals at Parkhead that season. He scored 2 in the 4-2 game. He scored 2 in the Glasgow Cup semi-final, which was played in April 69. And he scored a hat-trick against Aberdeen in the Scottish Cup semi-final, which was played at Celtic Park.
Uh-huh. Tell me, does anyone know, I have this strong memory that was the first season that the Rangers' end was covered. Am I wrong?
Correct.
I thought it was the season before, or am I getting mixed up with Hampden?
It was the summer of 68 it got covered.
Because I remember there was a game later on, somebody had spread 4-2 on the back of the wall at the Rangers then. And I thought, why haven't you cleaned that off the wall?
I found some footage of that game, poor quality footage, on a website with no commentary at all. But it was about 12 minutes of highlight of that 4-2 win for Rangers at Parkhead, and I mean, it looked as if it could have been about 6 each.
Yes.
There was so many chances at both ends, but Rangers were 2 up in about a quarter of an hour. We got back into it. I think we got a goal controversially disallowed, which would have made it 2-2. And then, you know, it was a bit sort of to and froing at the second half, but Willie Johnson clinched it with a header down at the Celtic end in the last minute. So it was a great win for them.
Can you guys remember, was that the game, two things. Number one, that Jock Stein initially asked the Celtic fans if they would go to the Rangers end, because the Rangers end was covered, and the Celtic fans refused.
Yes.
Or the Supporters Association rather refused. But the other thing as well, was that the game that they asked the Celtic fans to stay on after the final whistle in an attempt to prevent any trouble?
I don't remember the second, but I think you're right about the first bit. And I think the argument was it was a better cover.
Yeah, yeah.
Because the cover at the Celtic end was crap. I mean, it really only covered half the terrace.
Mm-hmm,
the one at the Rangers end was a more modern, more like the one at Hampden.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in Joe Steen's mind, who wasn't as tribal as us really, it made sense for us to decant and that become the Celtic end. But not going to have it.
And actually, by putting the roof on the Rangers end at Celtic Park, it meant that It just shows you how things change. It meant that Celtic had more covering for supporters than any other ground apart from Wembley in British football. So we were at the forefront because, of course, Hampden never really got a covered Celtic end until they decided to
seat it.
Stick seats in it. We were always uncovered there.
There's a wee anomaly here as well, and as much if you're talking about the Rangers games, we won the two League Cup games fairly convincingly, for what I can gather, and yet we lost the two League games. And I think it says a lot for the team's determination that you lose probably the two most important league games of the season, but you still end up winning the league by about 5 points.
They won it comfortably. It wasn't like the previous, it wasn't a nail biter. They'd won the league quite comfortably.
Yeah, I think both teams dropped
to their biggest rivals.
Yeah, I think both teams dropped a lot of points. Rangers in particular, after beating us at Parkhead, they then drew their next two matches, so they just frittered away the benefit of winning at Celtic Park quite quickly in the next couple of games. And by the time we played them on January 2nd, we were 5 points ahead. And then after losing that game at Ibrox, when John Gregg scored, Rangers again were a bit inconsistent and dropped points. And I think that was the story of their season. They didn't have the consistency of the previous season when they went all the way. They nearly went all the way to the death unbeaten. And I think Celtic too were a bit inconsistent at times, dropped a number of points before Christmas in games we would have been expected to win. And hence the lower points totals for both teams.
Yeah.
If you look at the
Celtic historian, he wrote in the book Glasgow Celtic 1945 to 1970. He says, he goes up to that season and he says, for the historian, such a period of success has its problems. The price of monopolistic success in a narrative is boredom. Celtic's latest victories in the Championship, 1968-69 and 69-70, have been accomplished so easily they defy recording in detail. Their closest rivals since the collapse in 67-68 appear to be suffering from a complex. Whenever an opportunity to surpass Celtic presents itself, the nerves begin to fray and tension sets in. He summed that whole league season up in that paragraph.
Well, wouldn't
the season he describes it?
Well, wouldn't that be a good comparison for what we've just seen just now? A bit of complacency amongst the 15,000 Old Firm fans who couldn't be bothered turning up to Celtic games when there was no Rangers for us for them to go and watch. And I know some people listening to this, if they are one of those Old Firm fans, won't like being referred to that, but they patently are if they couldn't be bothered turning up when there was no Rangers in the league and 15,000 of them didn't. And then, in addition to that boredom bit, you do have Rangers had an opportunity to do something this season, and the minute they got neck and neck with us, they blew it. Yeah. The reason we're going to be proclaimed champions sometime shortly is because of how much they blew it when they came neck and neck with us. Two seasons in a row.
Yeah.
Mm.
But in the
68-69
season, at one stage they looked as if they were going to launch a major challenge when they spent £100,000 buying Colin Steen around about October. So there was no transfer windows in those days. You could sign players anytime. I mean, Colin Steen's just 21 years old. He scored 8 goals in his first 3 games for Rangers. And I think they saw him as somebody vastly superior to Alex Ferguson. The problem with Colin Steen was his indiscipline. Mm-hmm. And he was rather prone to getting red cards unnecessarily. I think twice he got red cards in league games that season when he'd already scored a hat-trick. And, you know, he was suspended a lot of the time. And, you know, that was maybe a factor for Rangers. That was a lot of money they spent on him. They signed Alex McDonald also around about the same time. He was somebody that we would learn to love to hate pretty quickly in a Rangers jersey, although he turned out to be, you know, a tremendous servant for them. And we ourselves had broken our transfer record fee by buying Tommy Callaghan from Dunfermline, a player that Jock Steen knew well from his Dunfermline days. And Tommy Callaghan, you know, initially he started quite brightly, got a few goals, got a run in the team. But by the business end of the season, you know, when the trophies were being won, you know, Bertie Auld had re-established himself in the Celtic team.
I always had the impression that when Steen managed Tommy Callaghan as a young player, he was a really terrific player. But he had a bad injury, broke his leg. And I don't think he was ever the same player again, even though we paid a lot of money for him. Maybe I'm wrong.
He was still a good servant to us. I thought he had a couple of great seasons, mm-hmm. really great seasons in the early 70s, where I think he was more confident and a more established player. But, you know, he was somebody that tended to divide the crowd. A lot of the fans didn't really like him much.
I wasn't a great fan of Tommy Callaghan.
I think the problem with Callaghan was that he was vying with Auld for a place in the team. Now, Bertie was coming on in years at that point, and I think Jock signing Tommy Callaghan, he was signing him with a view to bedding him into the team for the future rather than playing him immediately. And it was the same with Harry Hood as well. They were two really clever signings because they were fantastic players for Celtic in the years to come. But at the beginning, both of them suffered because they were being compared to the Lisbon Lions who were still there. And it's only when the likes of Bertie Auld and Willie Wallace moved on that I think that the fans accepted Callaghan and Hood for what they were. And just to go back to Colin Steen there, I always remember my dad saying that, first of all, for a Scottish club to pay £100,000 in 1968 is, I would think, the equivalent of a Scottish club paying £10 million these days, to put it into context for any younger listeners who are listening into this. Another thing that my dad always says about Colin Steen is, the Rangers fans expected Colin Steen to run down the wing and cross the ball and run in the middle and head it into the net. The expectation that was such on him that he actually thought that the expectation weighed Steen down in the end, because this one player was expected. He was a great white hope. He was a guy that the Rangers fans hoped was going to lead them to success and eclipse Celtic, and it just wasn't possible.
Celtic sold Joe McBride in that period.
Yeah.
To Hibs.
That's right.
When they brought in Harry Hood, they sold Joe McBride.
Well, they sold Joe McBride earlier because, I mean, one of the games that I remember most vividly from that season was a game at Easter Road in November 68 when Joe McBride scored against us. And I wasn't at the game, but I listened to it on the BBC radio, the second half commentary, and I remember Hibs went ahead 2-1 with just about 14, 15 minutes left, and Celtic looked in a bit of trouble. But we scored four goals late on to win 5-2. But yeah, Joe had scored a couple of goals for us that season, but he must have been transferred around the end of October, something like that. And he certainly scored against us in that 5-2 game at Easter Road. And Harry Hood came in March, so
he scored against Morton. He scored against Morton in the end of October, and then by the time they played the Hibs, which was November, he was playing for the Hibs.
Right, and Harry Hood came in March, so we topped our Tommy Callaghan fee. I think we paid about 40 or 45,000 for Harry Hood, you know, at a time when Rangers were spending 100,000. So,
there was a great song about Harry Hood, and I think the math is slightly skewed, but I think we can forgive them at the time. It was Harry, Harry, Harry Hood. He's half the price and he's twice as good in comparison to Steen.
Yes, no, it was, we don't need no...
Colin Steen.
Eusebio or Alan Jolzien.
We've got someone
twice as good. That's it. We've got Harry Hood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
referring to? I commented on Twitter the other day about that game against the Hibs, sitting in my room at college, listening to it on the radio, and it was a brilliant second half. Was it when the Hibs took the lead? Good goodness. But they played fantastic. I think Big Yogi scored 2 wonder goals.
Yes.
And Billy scored.
Well, it was a great season for John Hughes. You know, until he got injured and he missed both the cup finals. But he banged in 15, 20 goals. He was a regular every week. And I think Yogi himself considered it maybe his best season in the hook.
It's interesting that Bobby Murdoch get the place in Liverpool, which was well deserved. But for what I can gather, if Yogi had have played to the end of the season, then I think that he might have just picked Bobby into being the player of the year. One wee interesting thing about that Hibs game, we were 2-1 down with 11 minutes left, and we scored 4 goals in 11 minutes. And I always remember my dad and his friends saying that in years later that it was amongst the best football. That last 11 minutes, no team in the world could have coped with Celtic at that point. They were devastating. The build up play, the clinical finishing, the pace, the speed that they played at. He says that the last 10-15 minutes was just a joy to behold.
Well, I remember that part of it was that he moved Hughes from the left wing into the middle when they went behind, and Pat Stanton had been very comfortable up until then, but Hughes terrorised them in the last part of the game and scored 2 goals.
Mm-hmm.
So Hughes was a great centre forward, although he played for Steen most of the time in the left wing. He was a good centre forward.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the earlier part of his career, he played centre forward more often than not.
He played centre forward in the first cup final, didn't he, Wayne?
Yes.
When Billy McNeil scored the winner, he was centre forward that day.
So, one of the interesting things just on the Rangers game, just as you guys were talking, I looked at up on the match report on Celtic Wiki, and it was a tremendous headline that would probably sum up the biases of the papers at the time. Rangers victory gives Scottish football new life. They were obviously chuffed a bit that there was a chance that Celtic might not win. Everything going.
Harry, see if you ever read Robert Kelly's book. It's the first Celtic book I ever remember reading as a boy, because obviously my dad had bought it, and I think it came out about 71, 72, and I made a point of reading it, even though I couldn't understand a lot because it referred to years previously. But what I remember is he references the New Year's Day game in 1969 at Ibrox, whereby Rangers won 1-0, and Kelly was in good health at the time, so he was at home and he was listening to it on television, and the television reporter said something along the lines of, "Now here is the result the whole of Scotland has been waiting for. Rangers 1, Celtic 0 Kelly took that in the wrong vein, in as much as he felt that the whole country wanted Celtic to lose. But I often think that there was a wee bit of paranoia in him at that point, because probably all that TV presenter meant was, this is the result the whole country has been anticipating, to see what the scoreline was, not the fact that Rangers had won. And I think towards the end, probably because Kelly in his life had witnessed a lot of bigotry and sectarianism, not only towards Catholics, but towards Celtic in general as a club. And I think that was an indication of the paranoia that was in his mind.
To be fair to, I know what you're saying, but to be fair to Sir Robert Kelly there, Archie McPherson, in his book about Steen, recounts interviews with Steen where they discussed the fact that even in Steen's view, the BBC were not very positive towards Celtic. He even questioned the number of Catholics who worked at the BBC. And Archie McPherson had that he was right, which is curious because Steen obviously wasn't a Catholic, but that was an issue for Steen.
Well, interesting. Well, there was a famous guy at the time. There was Blue Peter at the BBC at the time, who we've got a Celtic Wiki story about, who is basically the guy who ran BBC Scotland at the time, who was a Rangers fan and didn't like Celtic.
That's correct. Yeah, because one of the things was that when he retired, Steen did the presentation at his retirement, and I think Archie McPherson commented on the fact that it showed that Steen is a bigger man than him, because he put personal feelings behind him.
What was his name, Peter? What?
Peter Thompson.
Peter Thompson, that's right.
Yeah. So
there was definitely an anti-Celtic bias at the BBC then, as I think there still is now.
The league back then, the Scottish First Division, consisted of Celtic, Rangers, Dunfermline, Kilmarnock, Dundee United, and for those listening, obviously, this is the order the league finished in. Celtic, Rangers, Dunfermline, Kilmarnock, Dundee United, St Johnson, Airdrie, Hearts, Dundee, Morton, St Mirren, Hibs, Clyde, Partick Thistle, Aberdeen, and relegated that season were Falkirk and Arbroath. One of the things that I really noticed during this time, you know, Hearts fans think of themselves as a big club, and in terms of supporters, you know, they should be one of the biggest clubs in Scotland. But they are regularly finishing mid-table or bottom half of the table in these league tables that we're reading out. And my memory of growing up in the late 70s was that Hearts were a yo-yo team who went down and up and down and up. Motherwell and Ayr United were the teams who got promoted out of the second tier, the second division that season. But the really interesting thing is something that you guys have commented on, is the results that season. If you look, 7th of September, Celtic beat Clyde. Then they lose to Rangers at Celtic Park. They draw with Dunfermline at East End Park. They draw with Morton in October at Capello. And then December, and again, I often think of how social media would have been in those days if it existed, with a December run like this. We'd draw away to Falkirk, who ended up getting relegated. We drew at home to Kilmarnock. We drew away to Airdrie. We then thumped Clyde 5-0. And then we lose to Rangers 2-1 on January 2nd. And again, getting back to what we discussed last week about the games in quick succession, there's a game on the 7th of December. Then a week later, the 14th of December. Then a week later, the 21st of December. Then a week later, the 28th of December. Then 3 days later, the 1st of January. The next day, we play Clyde on the 1st of January. And then the next day, we play Rangers. And then 2 days later, we're at home to Dunfermline. And then it's another week before we play Aberdeen. It's a remarkable set of fixtures. And again, as we talked about last week, Lackey, I know one of the things is that was the reason for having local teams play each other around this time, because obviously transport links, but very few people had cars and the public transport wasn't on. How the hell did people get to these games?
Well, as I said to you, the supporters clubs would still hire the buses, because when I was in St. Bartholomew's supporters club, there was a bus for every game if you wanted to go. And then there was for away games, you did have football specials. In fact, I've got a story about football specials for the night we won the league, which we could come to. But the transport is never really an issue if people want to get somewhere.
So we'll take a break from the league following the defeat at Ibrox, and we'll talk about the European Cup campaign that season. So because we'd already tied up the League Cup, we've got a Scottish Cup to come. So could we have another remarkable season of sweeping the board? So first up, we have St Etienne. So they are just starting to become the team that they would become in their domination, in their place in European football in the early 70s.
So, sorry to interrupt you there, Harry, but do you want to discuss the Ferdinand Suárez thing first?
Yes, because that's very important. So, actually, Celtic were drawn against Ferenc Varos of Hungary in the European Cup, for the first round of the European Cup. And at the time, the Prague Spring was taking place to discuss what I mentioned earlier for younger listeners. So this was all behind the Iron Curtain, and Czechoslovakia before the Second World War had been quite a progressive country, and we saw that with the fall of the Iron Curtain, where the first president of a free country was a poet. So they were always a much more cosmopolitan country, and they had the Prague Spring, which was an uprising against the oppression of communist dictatorship, and that was repressively crushed by the Soviet Union. Celtic therefore refused to play any team from behind the Iron Curtain. Bob Kelly is quoted as saying, "Celtic will hold their heads high for what they did. There are things for Celtic more important than money." So, Robert Lackey Saint, do you want to talk me through those events?
Yeah, I mean, I remember the invasion of Czechoslovakia quite vividly on our old black and white television. Mm-hmm. And it happened in August. I think it was the third week in August when the tanks, it was something like 2,000 tanks and 500,000 soldiers from different Warsaw Pact countries moved into to crush the Czech government of Alexander Dubček. And I think Bob Kelly's view initially was that we shouldn't take part. You know, it's maybe not safe to visit any of the Warsaw Pact countries. Interestingly, Leeds United spoke out against our view because they were still playing Ferencváros in the final of the Intercities Fairs Cup, which had spilled over into August and September of the new season. So that final hadn't been wrapped up at the end of the previous season for reasons which I can't remember. But a lot of the countries did support Sir Robert Kelly's view, and there was a bit of a standoff with UEFA. The UEFA then there was a compromise proposed whereby the draw would be done again and the Western European teams would play against each other and the Eastern European teams would play against each other, and then they would revisit the situation by the time the second round came around in November to see if the situation in Prague had quietened down. The Soviets complained about that arrangement, and in the event the Russians, Polish, Hungary, East German, Bulgarian teams, their champions, all withdrew from the European Cup, and there was a redraw, and we got St. Etienne, the champions of France. And the other quote from Kelly afterwards was, he said, "An overwhelming majority of our supporters agreed with me that there was no point everybody feeling sorry about the situation in Prague if nobody did anything about it, and we all just continued to play ball. What we as a football club could do, of course, was limited, but I personally was perfectly prepared to pull my club out of the European Cup on a matter of principle." So I think that was the background and set us up for a couple of games against St. Etienne. The first leg went badly. We were two down at half time in France, and we survived any more damage to the scoreline in a pretty fraught second half display, and we were in danger of going out in the first round for the second season in a row. And I think Jock Steen was probably a bit relieved that we managed to get back to Glasgow with the tie still alive, and but obviously we needed a minimum of two goals to get through. And I remember being at the second leg and being in that little uncovered area between the jungle and the Celtic end, and I had a fabulous view of Tommy Gemmell's penalty right on the half-time whistle. And I remember we were playing in an all-white strip that night, and the second half was one of those really euphoric Parkhead European nights. Jim Craig got a very rare goal to level the tie, and in the last 20 minutes, Stevie Chalmers and Joe McBride scored to take us through. So, and I, the other thing I remember about the night was the desperate crush trying to get out the ground at the end in Janefield Street. And my dad's comment to my mum the next day was that, you know, I don't think Robert's feet touched the ground for about 50 yards, but we just got carried in the sway of the crowd. And it was pretty dangerous until we got to the Gallagate. So a great night for the club and marvellous performance.
There's interesting footage actually that you can find on YouTube. Certainly it's in French, and I would love to see the, or hear the translation. And it's black and white footage. It lasts for about 7 minutes, and it shows you that the St Etienne players going into Celtic Park through the old front door. It shows you them in the dressing room before the game. You know, they're very cosmopolitan team. You know, they're in good shape. They're all good looking boys, to be honest. And they look as fit as fiddles. So, and it shows you them coming in after the game, and it's as if they've literally lost a battle. They're covered in mud. There's a lot of guys limping. There's a few guys with cuts and bruises. And it does give you that feeling of the defeat. And I would love to, as I said, I would love to have heard or read the translation. But the most interesting thing for me is it shows you they're busking back into Glasgow after the game. Now, it's either London Road or the Gallagher. It's really difficult to recognise where it is. But obviously Glasgow at that time has gone under a lot of renovation. And as much as the old tenements were lying derelict, just waiting to be demolished. And it looks like it looks like carnage. You know there's these big black buildings in the dark of the night, and they're clearly uninhabited. And you can see the St Etienne players looking at the window, thinking, "My God, what kind of place is this?" Because it's easy to forget how grim it was in the late '60s, right through to the '70s, in terms of the regeneration of the city.
Right away through until the early '80s, you know, it was, yeah, things were grim.
When they made the original Tinker Tailor Soldier Spy, part of it was filmed around Celtic Park the night there was a game on. And you can see the floodlights.
Mm-hmm.
And you're supposed to be in Bulgaria, I think. Seriously. Well, if you ever got a chance to watch the original Tinker Tailor, the bit when he gets sent over, I think it's Bulgaria, one of those Far Eastern European countries, and there's a game of football on, and it's Celtic Park. The lights are on in the background. But it's all around Barrowfield.
I mean, the interesting thing about my recollection, obviously I was born in 1970, so my recollections of the politics of the Soviet era really start in the mid to late 70s. And my recollection was that Yugoslavia was not a communist state in the way everybody else was. So it was interesting that Yugoslavia and Romania were kept separate from this being barred from European competition. Because after we beat St Etienne, we then went on to play Red Star Belgrade in the next round.
Yes.
So we did end up getting a team from a communist country in the next round, where we thumped them 5-1 at Celtic Park and drew 1-1 away. Do you have much recollection of the St Etienne or Red Star Bell game, Slacky?
Well, I remember the night they played St Etienne. It was relief more than anything else that they got through. But the night they played Red Star Belgrade is famous because of Jimmy Johnson's performance. And you can see that in video. As you can see the St Etienne game in video too. I think it's important to stress how important Tommy Gemmell's goal was. You know, if you score a penalty just before half time in a game where you're two down, what a difference it makes to morale. You know, it gives Celtic a big lift for the second half, letting them in a goal behind rather than two goals behind against St Etienne. But the Red Star Belgrade game is sort of part of Celtic folklore.
I was at that game against Red Star. I mean, the Yugoslavs were not part of the Warsaw Pact, which is why they had not withdrawn from the tournament. They had their own approved dictator in Tito at the time. And you know, it was very different from the Red Star game because I had barely sat down in my seat in the old stand when Bobby Murdoch thrashed one in from 25 yards in the first 2 minutes. It was a brilliant start down at the Celtic end of the ground. And then they equalised before halftime, so they got the away goal, and it was, wasn't looking great, but I think Big Jock had even gone public the weekend before the match, and he promised Jinky that if we won by four goals, he wouldn't need to travel to Belgrade for the second leg. And, you know, Jimmy Johnson's performance in the second half was legendary. You know, people will agree and disagree on what were the greatest games that Jimmy ever played in his career for us, but I think by everybody's reckoning, the Red Star game would be one of his best three or his best five games ever. And in the second half, he scored two, he set up two. And, you know, the legend is it that he ran back to the halfway line after scoring the fifth goal, a couple of minutes to go. And the only thing he could say was, I'll no need to go, because Big Jock had promised him that a four-goal victory would mean no flight to Belgrade for him. And, of course, he held Big Jock to that commitment. And despite, you know, a lot of people in Europe and a lot of people in Yugoslavia were desperate to see Jimmy Johnson play in the return leg as well. But, you know, the end of the second leg was a fairly uneventful 1-1 draw. But I read, you know, this was the first season when we had the old Playing for Celtic annuals that used to come out every year, edited by Roger Bailey, who I think was with the Mirror or the Post. And I was having a look through it, and the last minute goal conceded in Belgrade, the players were really unhappy at conceding. They wanted a clean sheet and they were not happy about it. And, you know, great attitude to have when you're 6-1 up on aggregate with a minute to go. So another fantastic scalp for us.
The interesting thing for me is that the Red Star had a player at that time called Dragan Zajic, who was reputedly the best winger in Europe at the time. He had apparently came to fame in the 68 European Championships, and he had a wonderful tournament. And the Yugoslavs rated him as being the best in his position in Europe. And I think Jinky that night played at a level which few other Celtic players have managed to reach, in as much as he proved that he was certainly that night he was better than Zajic. And you know, you've got people like George Best and Gianni Rivera who were the main players in Europe at the time. You know, Jinky was right up there in that stature as being regarded as one of the best players in European football. And I always remember, I've told Harry this before, he sort of laughs at it. In 1975, my parents took me on holiday to Yugoslavia, and in 1976 we went on holiday to Romania. I don't know if they had a fetish for like communist dictatorships or something.
I've told you before, your dad was a spy. You've never worked this out.
So, you know, and we're fig over it as well. We didn't come from anywhere plush. So we were going to these places and seeing a lot of actually, you know, like Govan was well-to-do compared to some parts of Romania, which, without getting into it too much, was absolutely desperate. But the reason why I'm raising this is my dad was in a bar one night in a hotel speaking to a couple of Yugoslavian barmen who spoke good English. And this was in 1975, 7 years after the game, and they were still raging that they didn't get to see Jimmy Johnson in the flesh. They couldn't understand why Jimmy Johnson didn't want to travel to Belgrade and play in that game. My dad tried to explain that he didn't like flying, but they were greatly offended because they saw it as a slight against their country that such a great player wouldn't come and play in the second leg.
Well, one of the other things from that game, Celtic, and I'm just, there was a newspaper headline in the Daily Record, handshake that cost £120. Celtic fan Jimmy O'Neill was fined by the court for running on the field to congratulate Jimmy Johnson. So there you go. A Celtic fan was fined £120 for running
That's
on.
That's a bit steep.
That is a bit steep again. To give some context to that, the average house price in the UK at the time was £4,344. So the average house price in Scotland would have been probably about £2,000 at the time. People's earnings would have been in the hundreds of pounds for the year, so maybe pushing £1,000 top whack. So that would have been a big fine at the time for going on and doing that.
See, the second leg in Belgrade, there's an interesting stat that's worth mentioning. Willie Wallace became the first Celtic player to come on as a substitute in a European tie, and he also became the first Celtic player to come on as a substitute and score in a European tie in Belgrade.
That's true.
Well,
the other thing, maybe the last word about wee Jimmy and Red Star, this was only a month after he'd had a massive bust-up with Big Jock. A game I was at against Dundee United, league game, quite a tight game as usual against Dundee United in those days. But Jimmy Johnson got substituted with about 10 minutes to go. And he stopped before he went up the tunnel and he said something to Steen. And Steen charged after him and I think sorted out wee Jimmy in the dressing room. The result was that Jimmy Johnson got suspended, I think, for 7 days, or it might have been 14 days. He got fined as well, I think, for his show of petulance towards Big Jock Steen. And, you know, so the relationship with them was pretty poor, but clearly Jimmy got over it pretty quickly. And as I say, only 4 weeks later, he was turning in one of the great performances of his Celtic career.
He claimed that he locked himself in the toilet because he realised that Steen was coming up the tunnel after him. He thought Steen was going to do him grievous bodily harm.
So we got past Red Star Belgrade. And again, I sometimes think when people make a big deal of this is the first time we've had European, you know, in the modern era, this is the first time we've had European football past Christmas since X year. To be fair to the modern teams, there are a lot more games to get through these days to play European football past Christmas. We played St Etienne, Red Star, Belgrade, and then we didn't play again until we were, because the next round was the quarterfinals against AC Milan in February.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to Milan, and we got a 0-0 in Milan. So we bring them back to Celtic Park. So, Robert, there must have been a lot of hope and expectation that if we go to Milan and draw 0-0, that when we come back to Celtic Park, we're getting to the semi-finals of the European Cup.
Absolutely. And I think this was everybody's expectation. The game in Milan had been played in a snowstorm.
Yeah.
And the match probably shouldn't have taken place. The weather conditions were so bad. They didn't even play with an orange ball or anything, which didn't help matters. Celtic might have won the away game. Big Yogi nearly won it for us near the end. We played pretty well. Selection-wise, Jock Steen had picked both Jim Brogan and John Clark in a slightly more defensive lineup. But 0-0 was considered a fantastic first leg result. And, you know, the return tie at Parkhead was a huge disappointment for everyone. Big Billy made a mistake after about 10, 12 minutes and we conceded. And that meant we needed 2 goals to get through. And we never really looked like getting them that night, as Milan just strangled our attacking players in the way that Inter had not been able to do in Lisbon 2 years earlier. The quotes from Gianni Rivera, who was the star of Italian football, and what he said after the match, he said, "This was the hardest match we have ever played, and it is the best victory this team has had."
Mm-hmm.
And the manager, who was Nero Rocco, who I think was quite a decent guy, actually, but Jock got on pretty well with him because we'd played them twice in North America the summer before. Rocco's comment was, we have done the impossible. And then there was a quote from Steen after the game. So after the game, there was a banquet for both teams, which seems to have been, you know, the order of the day at the time, rather than teams just flying straight back right after the final whistle. So there was a banquet after the game, and Jock Steen got presented with something called a Sword of Honour for services to football. And he was actually presented with a fairly intimidating silver sword. And the only previous winners of this had been Stanley Matthews, Pele and Matt Busby. And Steen, when he received the sword, was quoted as saying, I just wish I'd been given this sword before the game because it would have helped me cut my way through the Milan defence.
Yeah.
So I thought it was, you know, great humour from Steen, you know, barely an hour after the end of the match. But this was the disappointment of the season, a huge opportunity lost. Milan went on to beat Manchester United in the semis, and they beat a youngish Ajax team in the final in Madrid. It could have been us.
Yeah. I think Steen, immediately after the game when he was being interviewed, said that quote about, you cannot legislate for human error. Because Big Billy made a gross mistake. He later said he should have just kicked it up the park, but he tried to control it and Pratty took it off him.
Pratty was one of the names when I was a boy that just brought up all sorts of horrible feelings. That I just remember my dad and his friends mentioning the name Pratty, and they wouldn't say anything else because it was such a horrendous memory for them. I think Billy, there's no doubt in his contribution to Celtic through the years, but that night that he made the blunder, and then the blunder in Milan against Feyenoord in 1970, that's two mistakes that cost us two games. And just to follow up with what Robert said there, I remember reading an interview in World Soccer years ago with Cesare Maldini, who was the father of Paolo Maldini. Was that George?
He was playing that night, was he not?
He was in the squad.
He was the assistant.
Was he? So, yeah, he was recalling that season, and he said, we knew that night in Glasgow that our name was in the European Cup, he says, because that was the only team that we feared, he says. We knew we would beat Man United in the semis, and we didn't have any problems with a fledgling Ajax team in the final, he says. But he says for AC Milan that season, the final was that night in Glasgow. We knew that night our name was in the trophy.
The Celtic team that night was Fallon, Craig, Gemmell, Brogan, who was substituted for Auld, McNeil, Clark, Johnson, Wallace, Chalmers, Murdoch, Hughes. Substitutes, this is one of the big changes, was the number of subs on the bench. There was Raith, O'Neill, Connolly, Hay, and obviously Auld, so there's quite a number of subs allowed at that time. But our European campaign was over. We drew 0-0 in Milan, and only a human error and some bad finishing by all accounts stopped us not getting through. And perhaps it could have been 68-69, could have been another all-conquering season, because we'd won the League Cup and we were going on to win the league. And then, of course, we had the Scottish Cup campaign, which kicked off on the 25th of January. And this is another campaign that took place wholly in Glasgow. We had some good luck of the draw. I mean, much as we all complain about the hot balls and Rangers' luck and everything, we do have to, as I'm going through this nine in a row, we do seem to have quite a run of only playing in Glasgow for our cup games, which at a time when travel would have been more complicated than it is today, would have been a great advantage to not have all that travelling taking place. We played Thistle and drew 3 each. So there was a replay, and we thumped them 8-1, quite a remarkable change of a turn of events. We then drew 0-0 with Clyde at Sheffield, and then there was a replay and we beat them 3-0. Then we beat St Johnstone 3-2. We thumped Morton 4-1 rather, and then there was the 4-0 final against Rangers. So Robert, do you want to kick off talking about our Scottish Cup campaign? Again, I'll look at these results and I think about social media. People would have been complaining that we scraped through against Thistle, scraped through against Clyde, and only just beat St Johnstone 3-2. So talk us through the Scottish Cup campaign, and I'll ask Lackey to chip in about his recollections.
Yeah, well, I think first of all, Harry, you're going to be making this comment about Scottish Cup campaigns being holy in Glasgow for the next few podcasts as well, because it was several years before we got an away draw outside of Glasgow. But this particular year, I was at the Thistle game. I think a big crowd in those days at Firhill for the 3-3 game, a game we probably should have won. We called it Jimmy Bone, who later played briefly for us. He scored, must have been in the last 20, 30 seconds to take it to a replay. But such was the quality of that game, and obviously a very high scoring match. We got a huge crowd turned out on the Wednesday night for the replay, and we won 8-1 against. And I remember Tommy Callaghan scored a couple of goals that night. So then on to Clyde, the game we mentioned earlier, Ronnie Simpson got injured in front of a big crowd at Sheffield. Tommy Gemmell had to go in goals for a significant part of the game. And, we got out of there with a 0-0 draw and then saw them off in the replay at Parkhead. In the semis, I remember, was a great game against St Johnstone. St Johnstone had a pretty good season. I think they might have finished about sixth that year. And they were an emerging team with some very good players, John Connolly, Henry Hall, guys like that. And that was a bit of a classic game, 3-2. The semi-final, I don't really remember much about it at all, against Morton, 4-1. And then that set us up for the legend of the cup final against Rangers. But I'll let Lackey come in before we talk about the final.
Well, my memory, I was at the final. I came home for the final. I hitchhiked up from Manchester just to go to the final. But I was up early. It must have been around Easter time, because I went to the semi-final of the Glasgow Cup, and he played mainly a reserve team that night. I remember that we were 3-0 down at half-time, and they fought back to 3 each, but Willie Johnson got a very late winner. In the second half, Celtic absolutely battered them, and they had a very, very young team. I think Doug Leash and people that were playing. Not sure. But I remember it was a very, very, it was a reserve team. Mm-hmm. And the Rangers beat them 4-3. And on the way home, my father said to me, the one thing you can bet your house on is that the Celtic will batter them in the cup final. Mm-hmm. Because if they've got that much difficulty beating the reserves, they're not going to beat the big team. And of course, the final was terrific. You know, we were without Jimmy Johnson and John Hughes.
The reason for the reserve team in the Glasgow Cup game was that Scotland were playing West Germany, I think, and Murdoch, Hughes, McNeil, Lennox, off the top of my head, Gemmell probably, thought about five of the best players in the team were all away to stay in the weekend in Lairds, I think, Artroon, for Scotland duty. So that explains why there would have been an inferior team.
Harry Hood was playing. I remember he
scored.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a wonderful game in terms of being a football match. But the fact that you get beat by the Huns was still annoying. I remember my father's reaction at the end was, they have no chance of beating us in the cup final.
Yeah, it was a Monday night game, Lackey. Willie Johnson got a hat-trick. And St Anthony's comments from earlier that, you know, Willie Johnson had a very productive season at Celtic Park that year, I think, 8 goals and all.
Yeah, the Celtic team that night was Fallon, Craig, O'Neill, Brogan, Hay, Clark, Wallace, Connolly, Chalmers, Hood and Callaghan.
That's not a bad team.
It's a very strong team. I had the impression that the younger players playing than that.
Well, you'd Hay playing, Connolly playing, Hood playing, Callaghan playing. They were all fresh to the team. Clark hadn't been playing for the first team. So,
well, there was no Murdoch, no McNeil, no Gemmell,
no Jimmy Johnson.
No Lennox.
No Lennox.
True. I remember the second half was brilliant when they fought back to get equalised, and then he popped up and got the winner. The year that big.
So the Scottish Cup final, we thump the Huns 4-0.
Yeah.
What's your recollections of the game, Lackey?
It was a more closely fought game for about 40 minutes than the eventual score looked like. It was quite a violent game. There was a lot of stuff going on. I remember Ferguson, I think, butted McNeil, and Murdoch was going to banjo. Celtic goalkeeper made a number of really good saves that day. And obviously they scored the early goal from Billy McNeil at the corner kick, which was a good start. But it was a close game, it was a tight game until Lennox scored the second goal, and then George Connolly scored the third goal. And after that, the procession.
Rangers, I remember the build-up to the game on television that morning was fantastic. That I hadn't really noticed in previous cup finals. And I remember the Rangers manager being interviewed by Arthur Montford or Alex Cameron or somebody on STV, and at the end of his interview he said we're only a few hours away from victory, and I think he was confident, maybe because of that Glasgow Cup win a couple of weeks earlier, but also because Rangers had won both league games that season, but they were without Colin Steen. For the match, because he'd been suspended again. And then the SFA's suspension of Wee Jimmy, which had only happened a few days before the final, was a bit controversial because he got suspended for picking up his third caution or yellow card of the season. So that also seems pretty harsh by today's standards. And as you mentioned, Big Yogi was injured. And so George Connolly came in wide on the right, and the man for any big occasion, Bertie Auld, came in on the left, who hadn't played a lot that season. And as Lackey said, it was a tight game, but pretty catastrophic Rangers defending for the goals. And for many, many years, George Connolly's goal in that game was my favourite ever Celtic goal. I think it was just the way he just nipped the ball off Greg on the edge of the penalty area, and then the nonchalance with which he sidestepped Norrie Martin in the Rangers goal, and he just tapped it into the empty net, and it was down at the Celtic end of Hampden as well to make it even better, and it was glorious.
The thing about that goal was the way that I think they all looked at the goalkeeper as if it was his fault, and yet Greg demanded the ball from the goal. If you watch it, he actually tells the goalkeeper, give me the ball. So the goalkeeper gives him it, and as he turns, Connolly takes it from him and just waltzes it in.
Is it true that there was a party arranged at Ibrox that night for the fans to get back to after the game? Because that was something that I was told in my younger days, that they had Ibrox lined up with accordion bands and all this kind of thing. And
They'd agreed to open the gates and let a big crowd in to see Rangers coming back with the trophy. And there was 133,000 at the game. And I think Rangers, potentially, they could have been having 80,000, 85,000 at Ibrox after the game if they'd won the cup, Andy.
There was no lapse of honour because of the
Because
of the 65 game. So, as I say, I think Rangers were pretty confident. You know, we hadn't beaten them in five league games, stretching back to the Lisbon season.
Yeah.
So Davy White was enjoying some success in some of these head-to-head matches. And, you know, it was the last throw of the dice, I think, for Alex Ferguson after that game, because he got blamed quite severely for not picking up Billy McNeil at that corner in the first couple of minutes. And, you know, that was... That set the scene. I mean, Rangers' season then only just got worse because they were still in the semi-finals of the Intercities Fairs Cup, and they were playing Newcastle United in the semi-final, and both of those legs were after the Scottish Cup final. And the first leg at Ibrox was 0-0, and then the second leg down at St James was just chaotic, you know, bottle throwing violence on the terraces. It spilled over onto the pitch. The match was stopped on more than one occasion. And I read from one observer on a Newcastle United fan website described the Rangers fans fighting police dogs on the pitch. So this match is still, you know, 51 years later, this match is still part of Newcastle United's folklore as well. So
it was famously recorded as part of the Lightly Lads. One of the Lightly film programmes had a Ranger supporter in the jail. For some reason, they were in the jail. I can't think why. But it was the night they played Rangers and they'd been rioting throughout Newcastle.
But it was quite tumultuous times in general. The idea of rioting was quite a common thing at the time. I mean, you'd had, during this time, you had the assassination of Martin Luther King, the assassination of Bobby Kennedy. You had anti-Vietnam War demonstrations across Europe, about outside American embassies. You had general strike in France. These were not genteel times. You know, you have all these images of the summer of love for the 60s, but they were not genteel times at the time. Some interesting facts about that cup final that I'll chuck in. The referee, that you mentioned earlier, Lackey Jimmy Callaghan, was the referee. He used a 50 pence piece, for the toss, which was interesting because decimalisation was happening in 6 months' time, so this 50 pence piece was just out. So we had a non-current coin being used to toss the coin. These are two stats that I find quite incredible. This was Celtic's first win in a Scottish Cup final against Rangers since 1904, and Rangers' first loss in a Scottish Cup final since 1930.
Yeah.
They had just not known defeat. And then the other thing, you know, the more things change, the more things stay the same. There was 200 arrests because the Rangers fans tried to invade the pitch when Celtic made it 4-0. And Celtic fans were heavily criticised in the press for booing God Save the Queen and waving the Irish flag throughout its duration.
Yeah,
that's a funny thing to think back on, actually, because I can vaguely remember some of the early 70s Scottish Cup finals, and it's true that the God Save the Queen used to get played at the beginning, and the Celtic end would just erupt in booing and jeering and singing the soldiers and things like that. So that get dropped in later years. I'm sure by the time mid-70s came that was dropped.
I can still remember actually being at, I think it would have been the 88 Cup final, and the pipe band on at half time, and I can remember being at the back of the Celtic end and a guy in a broad Glasgow accent shouting, "Get these Scottish bastards off."
Good lad. John Rafferty, remember the great John Rafferty?
Yeah,
the Scotsman.
Yes, he wrote a piece for The Observer after that game where he described the break-in after the fourth goal, and he said that most of them were trying to get out. They weren't all trying to get onto the pitch.
Yeah, yeah.
He says, but the Glasgow police say this to a man, forced them back and said, "Aye, you'll watch it."
So the Celtic team that day was Fallon, Craig, Gemmell, McNeil, Brogan, Connolly, Murdoch, Auld, Lennox, Chalmers, Wallace. That was the Celtic team.
It's interesting, actually, because in later years, I had the pleasure of being in Bertie Auld's company. And Bertie Auld told us that the difference that day was that teams in those days played a rigid 4-2-4 formation where you had two wingers. Very attacking formation, which probably explains why we talk about these games and there's so many goals, because both teams played attacking formations. Now, what he said was, we know Jimmy Johnson and know John Hughes, who were Celtic's wide players. Jock Stein had to be pragmatic, and they put George Connolly wide right and Bertie wide left. But what he said to them was, he wanted them to drop back to the halfway line and not play as orthodox wingers. The Rangers' fullbacks at that point weren't sure what to do, so they followed their markers up to the halfway line, which left Chalmers and Lennox against the two exposed Rangers defenders, who would have been Greg and McKinnon. And apparently, Chalmers and Lennox absolutely roasted them for pace that day. The two of the Celtic goals were by Lennox and Chalmers, basically running into space, nobody near them, and scoring. But Bertie's point is, he says, that game was one of the tactics board before the game. He says, and when Jock Stein showed us that in the board, he says, I could not believe how identical it became on the field of play. He says, because everything that Jock had told us was going to happen, happened. The Rangers fullbacks get sucked up the park, and the Celtic attackers, with their pace, absolutely ripped them apart. And he says that game was down to Jock Stein's tactical brilliance, no doubt about it.
The fourth goal is, I love watching the fourth goal, because they break up a Rangers attack and the ball gets kind of knocked forward to Chalmers, who just ambles down the wing and pokes it in with his toe. It's as if he's in a bubble. Nobody comes close to him. And they were just demoralised. It was brilliant.
The other thing, you two guys will remember this better than obviously I've been told it. There's a friend of mine, his father told me a story that Celtic were 3-1 on the day to win that game. Now, 3-1 in a cup final for a Celtic team at that time would have been phenomenal. And this guy put a fiver on Celtic to win that morning. And that was a lot of money. I mean, a fiver in the days would have been a huge amount of money for a working class man. But he'd such faith in Jock Stein and Celtic at the time, he thought, I'll be getting £20 back in the Monday morning. And he bought a carry out, maybe about a dozen cans of beer, him and his friends. And they just put the beer down in the terrace and then looked up, and Billy McNeil scored with a header. And I remember saying to him, what happened to your carry out? He says, oh, we never saw it again. He says, because it's pure carnage. He says, you people swaying back and forward. We never saw the beer for the rest of the game. And I said, but you know Maddie? And he says, Maddie, says, I knew right there and then I was getting £20 on Monday morning. He says, I wasn't mad, I was delighted.
Tremendous.
So, my brother would be the person to ask about bets. He always knew what was going on in terms of betting games. I had no idea. I had no real interest. Can I tell you a wee story about the night they won the league?
So, yes, because I was going to say, so what that did was, that secured a treble for Celtic, because the week before, just a few days before, we had drawn with Kilmarnock to secure the league championship. Quite a remarkable run of games to secure the title, where we drew at home to Airdrie and drew away to Kilmarnock. But as we said earlier, it was Rangers' poor performances that were helping us get over the line with that. Yeah, we'd won the treble, we'd won the league the week before, so tell us your tale, Lackey.
Well, I think they were two down at half-time at Kilmarnock.
That's right.
And then, I think Murdoch, did Murdoch score?
Yeah,
Murdoch scored. Gemmell. Gemmell, he scored the equaliser by a penalty.
In the 90th
the
minute.
Yes,
it was very, very late.
It was a Murdoch shot that Frank Beattie, the Killy captain, headed into his own net.
Yeah, but Murdoch scored very, very late. Gemmell scored very late with a penalty, and that was a League One. So from half-time gloom and doom, it was euphoria at the end, because you knew the league was won. But that was one of the nights I took the football special from Glasgow to Kilmarnock. Now, I don't know what happened, but we were sidetracked on the way home, and we sat in a siding for about an hour and a half. For no obvious reason, the train never moved. It left Kilmarnock, then it went into a siding, and we sat there for ages and ages and ages, and then eventually we got home. And I always wondered what was going on there.
Well, maybe they just didn't want you. They were trying to keep you away.
I was telling Irene a wee story today. You know Ken Bruce?
Yes.
Well, he tells a story about he used to be the announcer at the Central Station. And one night Rangers had been to Kilmarnock and lost. And as the train came in, he said over the loudspeaker at the Central Station, "Down the track the train comes puffing. Kilmarnock 2, the Rangers nothing." And he got disciplined for it. He said, his boss suggested he could have started a riot.
Exactly.
So, as I say, Celtic were treble winners. They secured the title, treble winners. The last few games of the season, they lose after securing the title and then winning the treble. They lose at home to Morton 4-2. So it's a peculiar season, that season, in terms of the number of games Celtic lost.
See the 4-2 game against Morton. It's worth mentioning here that there was a guy called Bartram. I think he was Scandinavian. I think he was Danish. He scored a hat-trick that night against Celtic. Now, there isn't many players can boast that they've scored a hat-trick against Celtic at Celtic Park.
In a year, they win the treble.
Mm-hmm.
But coming just...
Well, two players did it. Willie Johnson did it in the Glasgow Cup, and then Barton. Okay. Yeah.
We'll see.
But it is quite...
The only other player I can think off the top of my head that scored a hat-trick against us at Parkhead for a Scottish team is Eric Blackney's.
Uh-huh. Yes.
The interesting thing about that cup final, though, was if you look at the two teams, the two squads, the Rangers had invested a lot more money in their team than Celtic. They were a much more expensive team to put together than the Celtic team. I mean, they had Pearson, they had Colin Steen, who didn't play that night, but I think they had David Smith and Andy Penman. People like that, you know, there's a whole bunch of
Kaya Hansen.
The story of the next 50 years, Lackey. The story of the next 50 years, they spent more money just to try and keep up with us.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was always my thing that the great Murray years, the 9 in a row, that they spent untold millions to beat some of the worst teams in Celtic's history.
I know.
But it was all the Bank of Scotland's money.
Of course.
Yeah. One other thing.
Sorry.
Why don't you go, Robert?
I was just going to say that, you know, just looking at the season as a whole and the, you know, a bit unfortunate in Europe, but another treble, and it was our second treble in three seasons. And I think little did anyone realise that it would be 32 years before we would next achieve the treble under Martin O'Neill. And it's one of the things I've found hardest to comprehend about this period of extreme dominance under Jock Stein. And even after this season of 68-69, we would go on to win the next five league titles. And in those five seasons, we would reach all 10 domestic cup finals.
Yeah.
But after the 68-69 season, we started to get into a bad habit of losing cup finals. And up until this point, 68-69, since Steen took over, we'd won 8 major finals out of 9 with a Kai Johansson replay game, the only blip. And so things were about to change in that regard. And we could have had numerous trebles in the next few years. But for one reason or another, which I'm sure we'll discuss in the future podcasts, it remained elusive to get that third treble.
Harry has often said on this podcast that trebles are very hard to win. We should never turn up your nose at the fact that we win a treble, because they are very hard to win.
Especially in those days of the late 60s, early 70s, when Scottish football was at a very, very high standard.
Yeah.
And we've talked in the last couple of programmes about how well the Scottish clubs were doing in Europe every season. And you wonder, you know, if the UEFA coefficient factors had been in place in the late 60s and early 70s, and there had been seeding and stuff, you know, Scotland's coefficient would have been extremely
high.
You know, for probably a 7, 8, 9 year period.
Well, I mean, one of the difficulties of winning trebles is a bad referee, teams have a bad day, player suspensions, player injuries, the other team plays well. All those factors in a one-off game make it remarkable to win all the key games at the key moments. But your point, Robert, about cup finals, I mean, we'll obviously be borne out in the next season when we've got the 69-70 season, when again we effectively win the cup final of the season, and we'll talk about this next week. We effectively win the European Cup final in everybody's mind the game before, when we beat Leeds in the semi-final.
Yeah, I've been reading a book that I actually bought it for my brother, because he's into racehorses and things, and I always get him a book for his birthday. But you know how when you buy a book now, you can see a bit of it in Kindle?
Mm-hmm.
So I read a wee bit about, and I thought, that's a good book. So I bought myself a copy, and it's about the Triple Crown in American horse racing. And the fascinating thing about reading is how many horses win the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness, and they look unbeatable, but they lose the Belmont. You know, they just don't turn up for the one that gets you the Triple Crown. It's a bit like that with trebles. You know, you can win two cups, but winning that third championship or that third title is not easy. So the present situation is something to be marvelled at and enjoyed.
Well, I talked about, I'm going to talk very quickly, one more thing. I talked about the things that were going on in the world at the time of all of this, with Kennedy, Martin Luther King assassinations and riots and stuff like that. One thing that happened shortly, well, I'll go through the films while I remember. I'll go through the films of 1969, because we're in season 68, 69. And I keep talking about how it's peaks and troughs with the films. So the top 10 films in 1969 were, in reverse order, On Her Majesty's Secret Service, James Bond, George Lazenby, which I saw a tremendous stat about George Lazenby. Do you know, if George Lazenby had stayed as James Bond, he could have been James Bond right the way through to the mid-1980s and still finished being James Bond at a younger age than Roger Moore had finished being James Bond. Goodbye, Columbus, don't know. Cactus Flower, don't know. True Grit, Paint Your Wagon, Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice, don't know. Hello, Dolly, Easy Rider, Midnight Cowboy, and then Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Quite an array of films in 69. But the big thing that happened shortly after the season finished, for Robert and Lackey to tell us your quick memories, man landed on the moon. Apollo 11 happened in the summer of 69. Yeah. So, Lackey, what's your memory of that? Don't tell me. I don't know, because I was in Manchester.
No. I was working the buses, and I stayed up that night to watch the moon landing. And I was on the early shift. There's a number, 37-1, was the first bus out of Langside Garage in the morning. It left at 3:15, just after the night service. It was the first bus out. So I was on that bus that morning. So I watched the moon landing, and I come down to get the night service bus into town to go to Langside Garage. And the moon was really clear. It was a lovely night. And I said to this old guy, isn't that amazing? There's a guy up there on the moon. He says, you don't believe that, son. So Hollywood. And since then, you know how they made that film? I don't know what it was called. They made a film where it was a sky.
Capricorn 1, it was called.
Yeah. Capricorn. Was that not about? Was it not about Mars?
My daughters are convinced that that's the truth, that we never landed in the moon, but I believe we did.
I remember it was just last year, the year before. Buzz Aldrin was away giving, you know, and he's in his 80s now. He was giving a talk and walked out, and some guy said something about it was all fate, wasn't it? And Buzz Aldrin just punched him in the face.
There's one other thing I want to, I know we're running short on time here, just before we go, because I want to see what George and Robert think about this. Robert Kelly got a knighthood in January 69. Now, but when I was younger, I remember my dad and his friends saying to me that Jock Stein refused the knighthood, so it went to Bob Kelly. Now, there's never been any evidence of that, and I often wonder why that Robert Kelly got it and Jock didn't get it.
I don't know.
I've got a couple of thoughts on that. I think Stein had been suggested for a knighthood the year before, but after what happened in Montevideo with the racing club games, I think his name was withdrawn from consideration. Mm. And in 68, Matt Busby had already, you know, was knighted because of Manchester United's success. But I think Robert Kelly's case was done no harm by his intervention on the Prague Spring that we talked about earlier in this podcast, and the kind of statesmanship that he showed at that time was a factor in his name being put forward and being accepted.
Yeah, I'm reading, I just quickly Googled it, Sunday Times piece, Harold Wilson withdrew Jock Stein's name because of the Battle of Montevideo.
Mm.
So that was the reason. Robert, your memories of the moon landing?
Well, they're completely incorrect, because I've got this vague memory of a television being wheeled into our class at school to watch it. But the fact that it was in the third week of July means it was definitely during the school holidays. So I remember excitement about it, and everybody knew the names of the three astronauts. And, you know, I definitely did watch it at some point on television, whether probably not live, but maybe, you know, on the news the next day. But, yeah, I mean, no big deal for me, quite frankly. These sort of things didn't excite me much then or now.
More important, the Celtic won the treble.
Yeah.
And with that, I will say, gents, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Obviously, the season 5 of the 9 in a Row Chronicles will be up next week, and that will be the season where the world turns to colour. And if you've been watching football in the last 50 years, it is the period when basically there was more TV on the television and every reference point starts, until Sky obviously then started making it when they were invented. Anyway, as I say, hope you enjoyed that. Hope you're keeping safe. Hope your family are well. Please look after yourselves, wash your hands, keep the social distancing, and we will get through this. Meantime, as I keep saying, if you can spare a penny, get on the Celtic FC Foundation website. They've just launched an initiative where they are feeding NHS workers in the Cathedral Hotel next to the Royal Infirmary. So fantastic work they are doing. This is me, Harry Beattie, saying please take care of yourself. Good night, and God bless.